Hello, space fans, and welcome to another edition of Space Fan News. This week, SOHO turns 20, space weather at Pluto, and Lisa Pathfinder launches. First up, now, there wasn't a lot of fanfare about this, but this week a spacecraft passed a milestone I actually think is very significant, especially if you're worried about leaving Hubble's successor, the James Webb Space Telescope, 1.5 million kilometers away at the L2 point, with no hope of servicing it. Last week, on December 2nd, the Solar and Heliospheric Observatory, also called SOHO, celebrated its 20th anniversary. Launched on the 2nd of December 1995 and operated by NASA and ESA, SOHO has quietly taken decades of solar data from the L1 point, an analogous spot to L2, only between the Earth and the Sun. L2 puts the Earth between it and the Sun. L1 is a place that enjoys an uninterrupted view of our star some 1.5 million kilometers beyond the Earth in the direction of the Sun. SOHO monitors the effect of space weather on our planet, and it plays a vital role in forecasting potentially dangerous solar storms. These storms are typically driven by coronal mass ejections, or CMEs, which propel billions of tons of electrified gas from the Sun into space at millions of kilometers per hour. Space weather is the term used to describe what's happening in our solar system under the influence of our Sun's activity. The Sun is a very active star, with solar storms and coronal mass ejections, CMEs, happening all the time. There is also a consistent solar wind in the form of radiation and charged particles that blow out into the solar system. The Earth is particularly affected by the solar wind because we're so close. CMEs can bombard our magnetosphere, affecting our satellites and power distribution systems. So, as you can imagine, the study of space weather is of particular use to us here on Earth. SOHO has studied more than 20,000 coronal mass ejections so far, pinpointing their sources on the Earth-facing hemisphere of the Sun and determining their speed and direction to provide up to 3 days' warning, which is a good amount of time to take action on Earth, like putting satellites into safe mode and preparing our power grids. But to me, in addition to all the great science, one of the most amazing things is SOHO has been up there for 20 years, getting bombarded by charged particles in the solar wind, facing powerful CMEs, and doing science in an area that, compared to the L2 point, is a pretty hostile place. And it's been doing it without a single repair mission. We can't go to the L1 point any more than we can get to L2. If something breaks, that's it. So, congratulations to everyone at ESA and NASA for a mission that was designed to go for only 2 years and has proven, among a great many other things, that we can operate a space telescope millions of kilometers from Earth for a very, very long time. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm not so worried about JWST now. Next, while we're on the subject of the Sun and space weather, astronomers at the Goddard Space Flight Center released a really cool visualization this week illustrating what the space weather is like in the distant solar system around Pluto. I've already talked about space weather as it relates to Earth, but solar activity and its associated space weather effects obviously aren't limited to our home planet. All planets in the solar system feel the effects of the sun's energy to some degree. And this week, astronomers released a fascinating model simulation of the effects of the Sun on the solar system as a whole, including the outer regions around Pluto. What you're looking at here is the result. The spiral structures you see are the outbursts from the Sun, primarily coronal mass ejections, which have enormous large-scale effects on the solar system. The ejections spiral out because the Sun and its magnetic field are rotating about once every 27 days, which twists the streams of the charged particles as they travel outward. The green color represents changes in the plasma density. These are the charged particles themselves, mostly electrons, flying out into space. Red represents their temperature, and the blue is the density gradient, or how fast the pressure changes as it travels. The white areas are the most interesting. These are the shock waves, when all three colors are at their maximum, which, as you can see, occur primarily in the inner solar system, and that's where the Earth is. So now you can see why we study space weather so closely these days. One massive CME headed straight at Earth can be, let's just say, problematic. But the context of this visualization was that astronomers wanted to see what the space weather would be like in the outer solar system as the New Horizons probe flew by Pluto last July. They wanted to test their models against the observations that were taken by the probe as it flew by. So they started their model simulation to begin on January of 2015, because the particles passing Pluto in July 2015 took some 6 months to make the journey from the Sun. These new models can track CMEs farther out than ever before, and astronomers are currently combing through the New Horizons data to see how well they did. I'll let you know. Finally, last week, on December 3rd, LISA Pathfinder launched on a Vega rocket from Europe's spaceport in French Guiana, on its way to demonstrate technology for observing gravitational waves from space.
Un top allumage et décollage de VV06.
Gravitational waves are ripples in the fabric of space-time and were predicted a century ago by Albert Einstein's general theory of relativity. But it turns out that measuring these things is pretty hard. We've already built LIGO, the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory, a ground-based instrument in both Hanford, Washington and Livingston, Louisiana, and they operated it between 2002 and 2010, and they didn't find any. They've recently started looking again using improved detectors, and just last September began formal science operations as the Advanced LIGO. Gravitational waves are detected, or hopefully will be detected, using a very sensitive technique involving interferometers, which use mirrors that reflect laser light in a way that it interferes with itself. By studying these interference patterns, astronomers can get a glimpse into what's causing it. If a gravitational wave passes through the interferometer, the lasers will be deflected a tiny amount because, as we know, light rays follow the curvature of space-time, and the amount of deflection tells us the amplitude of the gravitational wave rippling through space-time. Now, while we should be able to detect these ripples on the ground, because they are so hard to see, the bigger we can make the interferometer, the more sensitive it can be. So we'd like to have one in space, and that's where LISA Pathfinder comes in. It is a probe designed to test the technology behind a future full-scale gravity wave detector. At its core is a pair of identical 46mm gold platinum cubes separated by 38 centimeters, which will be isolated from all external and internal forces acting on them except for one. Yep, you guessed it, gravity. The mission will put these cubes in the purest freefall ever produced in space and monitor their relative positions to an astonishing precision, laying the foundations for gravitational wave observatories in space. LISA Pathfinder is on its way to the L1 point, some 1.5 million kilometers from Earth towards the Sun. Now, the L1 point may sound familiar. This is also where SOHO is, and it has been for the last 20 years. It finally gets some company. LISA Pathfinder is expected to reach its operational orbit about 10 weeks after launch, in mid-February. After final checks, it will begin its 6-month scientific mission at the beginning of March. Well, that's it for this week, space fans. Thank you all for watching. And as always, keep looking up. Okay, well, you're looking at the first space fan news done from my portable studio. Right now, I'm in a tiny room where I've got all my equipment set up. I'm hoping this will work out. I'm testing this out because I need to be able to do space fan news from anywhere. So this will be my first one. Next week, I may be experimenting with a green screen. What you see behind me here isn't my library. Sadly, it's not. That's the library. That is a mural of the library of the House of Lords. I thought it'd be a pretty good backdrop for this Spaceman News. I also want to thank all the Patreon supporters, all of you who have taken the time to give some money to support Spaceman News. It helps so much. I can't thank you enough. And if you find Spaceman News valuable enough, I hope you might consider contributing as well. It goes a long way to improving some much needed production quality, obviously. So, and you can also let me know whatever stories you'd like to see on Spaceman News as a patron, because I will look there every week to see what you want. Okay, guys, I'll see you next week, and thanks again.